Good evening, and welcome to our first ever virtual Golden Rams reunion celebration, honoring the Philadelphia College of Textiles and Sciences class of 1970. I'm Jeff Spence from the Office of Alumni Relations at Thomas Jefferson University. And on behalf of the university, thank you for joining us this evening and congratulations on your 50th reunion. Though we know this is not how you would have pictured celebrating your reunion 6 months ago, and we would very much have enjoyed celebrating with you in person, we hope that tonight's program helps to commemorate this important milestone and help you to reconnect with your classmates and former professors. We are looking forward to welcoming you back to campus at homecoming next fall to formally celebrate with your classmates when it is hopefully safer to do so. Now, to begin our program, it is my pleasure to introduce your classmate, Dan McCrate, to welcome you on behalf of the Class of 1970 Reunion Committee. Thank you.
I would say welcome to everyone, especially my classmates who graduated with me in 1970 from a little college on the corner of Schoolhouse Lane and Henry Avenue, which was only a mile from the best cheesesteak in Philadelphia, as I recall. 50 years is interesting. When I look forward to 50 years, I can't imagine ever making it. But when I look back from this vantage point, 50 years, it was brisk. And there were a lot of changes in my life, just like in yours. There were changes in the industry I had a vocation in. There were changes in family. And there have been changes at the university. We're no longer a college, we're a university. And a lot of programs we didn't have before. So we'll hear from Dean Kander in a bit about those programs that still exist that we perhaps graduated from and others and how the university is growing and expanding. I am representing a little committee called the 50th Reunion Committee. Along with me, Jean Drew Brown served. She was from the class of 69. Philip Lanitas served. He was one of my fraternity brothers. And Stuart Siegel. We didn't have to work hard because of the way we're doing it, but we were certainly willing to be called on if we'd had to do it a different way. And maybe next year we'll get to do that. I was asked to think about a couple of personal notes. I'm from Greenville, South Carolina, which used to be called the textile center of the world. Not anymore. There are not many textile plants left there. But when I returned there after doing undergraduate work at Philadelphia Textile and graduate work, one of my friends said, "Danny, what'd you learn up there at that textile college? You learn how to be a loan fixer?" I'm not even sure. They call them weaving technicians now. They don't even call them loom fixers. But it made me think, what did I really learn up there? I learned a lot, but the thing I learned most was this desire to learn and how to learn. I remember taking second interviews and thinking to myself, I don't know if I'm ready to go to work. I need to go learn some more. So I did. The most significant event for me at Philadelphia Textile may be different from yours, but I'm an avid sports fan. I never missed a home game on our two nationally ranked collegiate powers, the basketball team and the soccer team. I didn't miss an away game once I got my 68 Mustang up there at the end of my freshman year. And I went to Evansville, Indiana, drove on snowy roads for 20 hours with four fraternity brothers crammed in my car, doing wheelies and U-turns on ice across the bridge in Cincinnati. Got to Evansville, Indiana, stayed in the dorm, and went to the two most marvelous basketball games in my lifetime. So, because I'm such a sports fan, I'm delighted to have some faculty here tonight, and included in that group is my phys ed teacher. Let me introduce you the faculty members that I know are on board. All of them don't have their video on yet, but you turn your video on and your mics on if you can, and say a word of hello in turn. Don't all talk at once. You don't have to raise your hand or anything, and I'm not going to call on you, but let's see if you can queue up and do it. We've got Peggy Gutman. We've got Dr. Steven Spivak from the textile department. We've got Dr. Harry Woodcock from physics, Stuart Borowski from the business department, and my favorite phys ed teacher, Coach Herb McGee. So take it away, folks, and have a word to say to the group.
Well, since I was first, maybe I can be first. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Hello, and I'm glad to be here to help you celebrate 50 years since your graduation. 50 years! I hope you've paused and had a little thought about what you were doing 50 years ago, who you were. I did, and it's a pretty scary thing. But I'm glad that you are celebrating your alma mater, celebrating the foundation that you got here with us, celebrating your friends, celebrating all the fun that you had, and the few of you I know, you had fun. Thank you for continuing to give back to the institution, no matter what it's been called over the years.
Hello, I'm Stu Borowski from the business school, taught accounting. I don't know if I'm on or not.
Turn your video on, Stu.
Turn the video on. Start video.
On the bottom left. Get your wife to help you.
Who's that?
There you are.
Okay, I'm on now. Okay, I'd like to welcome the class of 1970. If my memory serves me right, you guys started in September of 1966 as freshmen, which happened to be my first year teaching at Textile. And if I remember, my memory serves me right, Herb McGee was an assistant coach to Bucky Harris that first year, if I'm correct. Right, Herb?
That's exactly right.
Right. You guys got out of school in 4 years.
Yeah.
It took me 49 years to get out of Textile, but I finally made it. Life is good. I hope all you people are enjoying life and staying well during this time. Great to see you.
And I can jump right in there with that, Stu.
Okay.
You got out in 49 years, and I'm still there. And this will be my 54th year as the head coach. And we saw a number of changes in my career. The biggest one has been the name and the change to Thomas Jefferson University. I think it's been a positive thing. I think it's really helped the university, not only Philadelphia University, Philadelphia Textile, but Jefferson's name as well. Now, going through what we're going through now, what we are doing with our team is we only can practice a couple days a week. Most of the kids are on virtual, and the ones living in the dorms, our players are there, and we're still operating the team. And we hope to have a season in the second semester. But when Dan mentioned that he made that trip out to Evansville, it really brought back a lot of memories for me, because people have asked me all the time in all the years I've been coaching, which is the best team I've ever had. And right away, automatically, it's the 1970 team. They won the national championship 29-2. They beat everybody bad. And they made me really look good, which is the main thing. But I still stay in contact with a lot of those guys. And I'm glad to be able to speak to you folks classmates of my former players, John Parentosi, Jim McGilvery, and Carlton Poole, the seniors on the team. And I'm glad to have you all folks back to celebrate your 50th anniversary. Time really flies when you're having fun. Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
You.
This is Steve Spivak. I'm looking dark. I had my wonderful IT wife trying to turn on my video camera. And I guess I'm used to Google Meets, but I can't seem to get it on with Zoom. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay. I'm sorry I look so strangely shadowed. Very quickly, I graduated textile engineering in 1963. And the most important part of that year was I and everyone else was honored that Herb McGee was also a graduate of 1963, if I'm correct.
That is correct.
I then went on for further studies and came back to the States in 1968 and joined the faculty of then PCTNS, Philadelphia University, and served there from 68 into 1970. So I may have had and been honored to have some of the 1970 graduates in my classes. I then left Philadelphia University and joined in textiles and fire safety engineering at the University of Maryland, where I stayed for 31 years. But I will tell you, I'm absolutely delighted to see the agglomeration of PCTNS, Philadelphia University, with Thomas Jefferson University. I think it's, again, a win-win for everyone. And I'm really impressed to continue to see how the combination matures and grows and expands. So congratulations all. Thank you. I'll go back to mute.
Since I don't want the physics professor to dominate this, what they all said. Congratulations.
Yeah, I don't add up. Well, thank you, folks. And it's good to see you again. I hadn't seen some of you since 1970. And how we've, I tell people I like to think that I'm aging gracefully. That's just the way it is. We have now what we're calling a Golden Rams Parade. It's a compilation of photographs that you folks sent in. And the university staff has put together. So let's enjoy our inaugural Golden Rams Parade at the moment and see if we see anybody we recognize. Well, that was the yearbook. I counted 110 members in our class, 16 women. I expect the university is a higher percentage of women now than it was back in 66 when we started at Philadelphia Textile. There are a lot of folks who have passed away and are not able to be with us tonight. I had a roommate at Philadelphia Textile for 3.5 years, a fellow South Carolinian. He was my roommate for 2 years following in grad school. And he passed away to health issues 3 years ago. Otherwise, he'd have been here joining in with us on this celebration. So I think we should take a moment, have a moment of silence as we observe memories of our fallen class members who have passed away. Let's do that. I counted 40 members of our class of 110 that have passed away. And I'm sure we miss them, those of us who, so many of those folks that I was close to at the university. So we'll miss them. Well, now I need to introduce to you main speaker for the evening, Dean Ron Kander. He joined the university in 2011, currently serves as the executive dean of the Kanbar College of Design, Engineering and Commerce, which is comprised of the School of Design and Engineering and the School of Business. Before coming to Jefferson, Dean Kander held positions not far from where I live at James Madison University and Virginia Tech. Mm-hmm. And prior to joining academia, I worked at EI DuPont in Wilmington, Delaware. So please join me in welcoming Dean Ron Kander for a few words.
Thank you all very much. Thanks, Dan. It's really a pleasure to be here and see all the folks that are a legacy of our great university. I'm going to share my screen and talk to you for a few minutes about what's happening at the university, especially in our college. So as Dean of Kanbar College, I feel like a lot of the legacy programs of the university are in my care. And so I subtitled today's presentation as follows, Kanbar College Back to the Future. And I'll explain to you why I feel like this is a back to the future moment for our college. So I won't spend a ton of time on this, but it helps set the stage. You know, 1884 is when Theodore Search there formed the Philadelphia Textile School as part of the Pennsylvania Museum and School of Industrial Arts. And contrary to popular belief, Herb McGee was not coach back then. But if I fast forward a little bit to 1942, that's when the first name change happened, Philadelphia Textile Institute. And in the 1940s is when the university moved up to East Falls. And that building there in the middle is what became Hayward Hall eventually, named after President Hayward. If we fast forward to 1961, we're at the second name change, Philadelphia School of Textiles and Science. And this is the name that you all will most resonate with. And in fact, the historic markers on campus, that's the name that's recognized on those historic markers, Philadelphia College of Textiles and Science. And there's a picture of some very 1960s clothing that some of the fashion design students were wearing back in the 1960s. we jump forward to 1999, that's when the next name change happened, the Philadelphia University name change. President Gallagher did that with the expansion of the programs that were outside of the traditional textile and fashion areas, business school, architecture, engineering, health sciences, some other programs. And that was the point that the comprehensive university started. You guys are right in there in between those two events in the Philadelphia College of Textiles and Science days. And if we go jump to the next milestone, that was the Spinelli years when Steve Spinelli became president, 2007. That was what I call the Philly U era. Really, that's when we grew a lot as a campus and grew up to about 4,000 students under Steve Spinelli's leadership. And then the most recent name change, which was the Thomas Jefferson merger, which now made us a comprehensive national research university with a medical school and the professional programs on East Falls and the clinical practices of the 14 hospitals as part of the enterprise. I arrived in between those two. So I was there between 2011 is when I was hired and asked by Spinelli to start the Kanbar College of Design, Engineering, and Commerce. And when I was looking at sort of what we're trying to do and what we're trying to accomplish, that's where my Back to the Future name came up, because I think you'll see that when you see what we're doing in Kanbar College, it looks a lot like what you guys experienced in the 1960s. It's just on a larger scale now with a larger base. So that's sort of the explanation of the Back to the Future title. So Kanbar College, named after Maurice Kanbar, alum from 1952, serial entrepreneur. Those of you who know of Maurice, you know, Sky Vodka, movie producer, medical product patents, food product patents, invented the concept of the multiplex theater, all kind of interesting things. He was just a serial entrepreneur, is a serial entrepreneur. He's about 90 now, either just turned 90 or he's about to turn 90, lives in San Francisco. Maurice had a very interesting spin on product design and development. Maurice always told me, a really cool product or service has three things. It's desirable, feasible, and valuable. And the reason we wanted to see the design majors, engineering majors, and business majors brought together was that he said, you know, on a really cool product, you hope there's a designer on the team who is looking at user experience, user pain points, and coming up with a thing that makes the product desirable to a consumer or a user. You hope there's an engineer on that team that's saying, great idea. What would it take to make it a reality? What are the materials? What are the technologies? What are the manufacturing processes necessary to make it feasible? And then you'd hope that there's a business professional on that team saying, great, but what's the business model? What's the value proposition? What's the sustainable business model that's going to make this thing survive as a business? If you think about design, engineering, and business being taught together, you should see the ghost of Theodore Search there. Because when he formed the Philadelphia Textile School back in the 1800s, that was the point. It was to teach textile design, textile engineering, and textile business at the same time to improve that industry. So a lot of the philosophy of what we're trying to do in Kanbar College matches the roots of the university. Now, if you look at our program areas, though, we have the traditional fashion and textile programs that existed when you were here. You know, we have fashion design, we have fashion merchandising, we have textile design, we have textile technologies, we have in textile engineering, we have all of the merchandising and technical and design programs in fashion and textiles. But we've expanded that base in the college into some other programmatic areas. We have a broader base of product design and development outside of just apparel and fashion and textiles, medical product design, consumer product design, soft goods, hard goods, engineering systems. We have the engineering and applied science degrees, mechanical engineering, textile engineering, biopharmaceutical manufacturing engineering, textile product science. So those degrees in the science and technology area. Then in our design areas have expanded into other design areas like communication and user experience areas with graphic design, with animation, which computer user experience, UX design, artificial intelligence, virtual reality, augmented reality, communication tools in our design programs. And then the business school has really expanded out into really focusing on business analytics at the undergraduate and graduate level, really focusing on quantitative data analytics using analytics and focusing on entrepreneurship and new businesses, definitely in the fashion and textile areas, but also into things like the business of healthcare, the business of health systems. So we've just broadened the programmatic focus, even though our theme is the same. We try to bring all those students together with a common core curriculum. So we actually have a series of things we teach that every student, no matter what major they're in, have to take together in classrooms. And that's really important because, again, I think it gets back to the roots of the place. So we teach everybody in mixed classrooms design process. And this is important because it's how designers think about problems, and engineers and business professionals have to understand that. This is how do you find that opportunity. But we also teach everybody business models. So the business students, of course, need to know this, but it's important that the designers and the engineers understand how business professionals think about problems. Then we teach a systems analysis course to everybody in mixed classrooms. And this is how an engineer thinks about a problem. So this is important for a designer and a business professional to understand how an engineer is going to analyze a complex system. And then we bring them together in the classroom in their junior year for a common research methods class. So they start to understand how they could use each other as a way to do research on a problem and gather what they need to know. And then we bring them together in their senior year again to practice what they just learned on a real problem from industry in mixed teams. So those capstone experiences are key. So if you think of those skill sets down the right-hand side, Dan mentioned how, you know, what he thinks he learned was how to think and how to think about problems. That skill set really is what is independent of discipline, independent of problem, teaches you how to go from information through critical thinking or inquiry to developing insights and then communicating those insights to other people so you generate knowledge. Because if you can't communicate what you've learned to a decision maker in a way that has them make a decision and reduce it to practice, then it really doesn't matter. So this set of skills is what we ask them to practice. And we ask them to practice it on these industry engagement and applied research projects. This is probably the thing I'm most proud of that we do in the college, because it really does harken back to the industry focus of Philadelphia College of Textiles and Science. This is just a brag sheet of just a few of the companies we've worked with in the last few years. I shouldn't just say companies because Department of Defense is there, NASA's there. So you can see that what we do is ask these companies to bring problems into the classroom, and then we mix students, not just mixed in discipline, but mixed in level. So we'll take freshmen, sophomores, juniors, seniors, grad students, and mix them together on problems so that the underclassmen get to see how an upperclassman or a graduate student deals with a customer. And that's a really important learning piece. So it's not uncommon to walk in and see a freshman design student in a room with a junior engineer, with an MBA student on the team and a fashion design student on the team from the undergraduate program and a merchandising student from the graduate program, all working on a problem together for NASA or somebody else. But we don't just stop with industry problems. We also have joined a bunch of consortiums of other universities and other organizations to try to expand outside the campus. So these are just a few. AFOA is Advanced Functional Fabrics of America. This is a group of 70 or so universities out of MIT is the lead that looks at functional fabrics and wearable devices for the Department of Defense. And we're part of that team. We're a member of another consortium called NIMBLE, which is the National Institute for Innovation in Manufacturing of Biologics. I know these acronyms are crazy, but we have a Jefferson Institute for Bioprocessing that teaches bioprocess engineering, which is basically chemical engineering with biological materials. And that consortium has about 70 or 80 universities, and we're a member of that. That institute also partners with an institute in Ireland, Dublin, called NIBRT, the National Institute for Bioprocessing Research and Training. So our graduate students in bioprocessing engineering can actually spend part of their time in Dublin studying there, which is one of the hubs for bioprocessing pharmaceuticals. We're a member of the Oak Ridge Associated Universities. That's what RAU is. That's really important because Oak Ridge is one of the national labs. This consortium of 120 universities lets us work with national laboratories. And Oak Ridge, for example, has two of the fastest supercomputers in the United States. So we can, you know, do computational and systems things with them. And then we also partner with government agencies. We have a large research group that's looking at hemp-derived industrial materials. And we actually belong to a group that's the Pennsylvania Hemp Steering Committee. And in fact, I'm chairing that for the Department of Agriculture. And we're looking at how we can build local supply chains in Pennsylvania that would allow businesses to take hemp as a biomass and create consumer and industrial products from the fibers and from the herd, the woody part of the plant. So these are just some examples of how we try to really, really enhance the educational experience beyond just the courses, because nowadays, and this probably was true when you were in school, the curriculum wasn't where you learned. You learned from the co-curricular experiences, the research, the projects. So that's what we've really focused our curriculum on. And it's working because we're placing our students in their discipline, jobs in their discipline, or graduate school in their discipline at 97% in Kanbar College. So the point is to get a job. We're industry facing, just as the place was when you were there in the 1960s. This is just one really fun example, just to show you how much things have changed. This is Leanna Richardson. She's a graduate from fashion design in 2017. She got her dream job at Mattel, the toy company. And that's what she's holding up is the newest American Girl doll that was released this summer. And she designed it. So she got to do the release of the newest American Girl doll. And she's only been there 3 years. So she's a leader in Mattel already. So that's just, you know, a really funny example of the kind of career a student has nowadays. So what I wanted to do is take a couple minutes just to show you what the physical facilities are looking like these days. You guys probably all know about Hayward Hall. That was around when you were here, and that's probably where you spent a lot of your time. To the right of that is Tuttleman, which is the building that most of the business classes are in the School of Business in our college. Bottom left there is the new Lawrence Field Deck Center for Design, Engineering, and Commerce. That's where my office, the dean's office is. But that whole building was designed around our curriculum. It was built after we started the curriculum. And all of those core courses that you heard about that I mentioned are taught in design studio format on two floors of this building. And then the bottom right there is the newest addition. This is the Jefferson Institute for Bioprocessing, which is actually a building located 7 miles north of campus of East Falls up in Montgomery County. And the reason we have it up there in an innovation park is because that's where the pharma industry is. So we put this smack dab in the middle of the pharma companies and so that our students get to experience the pharma industry right down the block. Inside, we've been modernizing our spaces, so you won't recognize a lot. Well, some you will recognize, some you won't recognize. These are just some of the laboratories with CAD capabilities in fashion, some of the knitting, the weaving machines that you probably saw but when you were here. There's the new Fashion Textile Future Center in the bottom left, which is where all of our fashion and textiles students can work together in collaborative teams. Top left is some of the bioprocessing equipment in the Jefferson Institute for Bioprocessing. There's the textile design studio space. The top right and bottom left are some of the engineering research spaces. And then you see some of the knitting, weaving, and printing lab space down in the bottom right-hand corner. So a lot of the spaces function in a lot of the same ways that they functioned back when you were there, but you'll see how much the spaces have been modernized. That upper left picture, believe it or not, is Hayward Hall. Hard to imagine that that's Hayward, but it is. I'm going to end with just a few slides on some of this year's accomplishments, because I feel like this year has been a banner year for the college. We opened the new Bruner Materials Characterization Laboratory this year. This is the new Ronson Health and Applied Science Center. In the bottom floor of this building is the new Bruner Materials Characterization Lab. This was a naming gift from Jeff Bruner, one of our alums. And it was what many of you might have known as the Grundy Lab back in the day. But this is the new Bruner Characterization Lab, Jeff's donation. is going to allow us to buy brand new equipment for that lab. We've bought a new Instron. We're buying a new scanning electron microscope. We've built a new environmental chamber for our infamous walking, sweating mannequin. This is one of only a handful of these in the world where we can put a piece of apparel on this thing and actually monitor the metabolic load on the mannequin and how sweat is wicked away and how temperature change occurs on the skin of this mannequin based on a piece of military apparel or sports apparel. School of Business has really been ramping up its faculty research. We had a gift from the Kodroff family. We lost Phil Kodroff this year, unfortunately, an alum, but his family, and he made a donation, a keystone donation for faculty research awards. And then other members of our advancement council have chipped in also. So we had a set of research awards. We had our inaugural award day just in September. And here's six faculty: Les Tandera, DK Malhotra, Ray Pateau, Tim Mooney, Neoka Wyatt, and Anu Dada. They all received awards for their published papers. And those six between them published over a dozen papers in the last year. So their research activity has really been enhanced. Fashion design program has really been flying. As many of you know, the fashion design is ranked in the top 10 internationally, number 3 in the United States right now. We just hired a brand new fashion design program director. That's our new director, Farai Samoy. Farai's actually got a really fascinating background. Farai was born in Zimbabwe and grew up in West Virginia. Natural combination, right? She went to WVU. She ended up in New York as a fashion designer. Designed for some names you might recognize, people like Beyonce and Jay-Z and Nicki Minaj, very modern pop stars, among others. And she opened up her own shop in Brooklyn called The Narrative, very successful. She ended up on the Netflix show, Next in Fashion. Actually, the first season was just dropped on Netflix. Spoiler alert, she didn't win this season, but she stayed competitive the whole season. So we got her. And she just started this year. So that's a really great addition to our fashion design program. And then there's the Jefferson Institute for Bioprocessing that I mentioned. Amazing, amazing facility. The top floor is completely set aside for protein-based drug manufacturing. It's a mock GMP facility. So it's like clean rooms. You walk in and you can be in a manufacturing facility making drugs on commercial size equipment. The cool thing about this place is that it has expanded this year like you wouldn't believe. This is one of the most successful ventures that Jefferson has started. We started this a year ago, so it was before the pandemic, but now that the pandemic has occurred, the need to use cell and gene therapy to grow new drugs has expanded. So we had the bottom floor shelled and ready to go for expansion. We've already outgrown that space, and the building next door to this one, we're actually negotiating more space with the university in this industrial park so that we can expand to maybe 3 times what we started at only a year ago. So this has been a great thing. It's one of the university's combined academic units and business lines because they do training of professionals and education of students all in the same space. Really cool facility. I'll end by just mentioning a couple things about our pandemic response this year, because I'm very proud of that. Kanbar College has been able to keep about a third of their courses are online, and the other 65% are either completely in person or what we call flexible hybrid, where some lectures are given online, but the students come into the studios and labs in smaller groups, and maybe half of them come in on one day, the other half come in on a different day, so we can de-densify and spread people out. And we've been able to keep our in-person research experiences going with undergraduate and graduate students. And right now, we only have a positivity rate of about 1.7% in COVID surveillance testing, which is way less than the city of Philadelphia. So it's actually safer to be on campus right now than it is to be in the city. So we're very proud of our response. I've been using the money from the Advancement Council to equip some of the labs and studios so we can spread people out, wear face masks, wear shields, and they can still get their work done in these spaces. So I'm really proud of the fact that we're offering hands-on experiences for students when many universities aren't. Our faculty research outside the business school has been very robust too. Our faculty in 1 year have raised $420,000 in external research support. They submitted 21 proposals and 12 of the 21 were funded and only four were rejected so far. So there's 5% success rate. For those of you who know university, that's unheard of success rate. So that money really helps support this idea of hands-on research for our students. So now you can see why my theme was Kanbar College Back to the Future, because hopefully you've seen we're doing the same things. The experiences are very similar to what you experienced when you were in school. But because of our short time frame, you can see I'm out of time. So I'm going to stop right there and stop sharing my screen so that you can keep the program going and see if there's any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Kander. That was a really fantastic presentation. We appreciate it.
My pleasure.
I'm Kazanjan Babian, and I'm from the class of 1995. So this year actually marks my 25th anniversary of graduating from Textile. And I would like to open the floor for any questions. And if there's anyone who'd like to pass any questions along, just at the bottom of your screen, there's the Q&A button. If you don't see the Q&A button, just move your mouse around a little bit and it will show up. Dean Kander, we've got a couple of questions here, and perhaps you can elaborate a little bit more about, with all the educational experience that students have on campus, how likely is the job placement once they graduate? You did say 97% either have job placement or go on to graduate school, but can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Sure. I'll give you one example data point here. The Jefferson Institute for Bioprocessing had their first class of master's students finish just in May. And at the height of the pandemic, they actually had 100% job placement, and they had multiple job offers each. So they did a really, really good job with that program. And right now, engineering is placed at 100% this year also. And the vast majority of our students do go to industry. But there are some students who want to go on for advanced degrees at other universities. Many are staying and doing a master's with us. So that's really nice. They'll do a five-year bachelor master's and then go to industry. We've been placing at Lockheed Martin. We've been placing at major manufacturing firms like Tenneco, Ford, and then, of course, the major apparel brands are all still hiring very strongly from our program. We have a really good career service office that helps line the students up. Plus, our alums on the Advancement Council often bring job opportunities to our students directly. So, yep, it's been working really well. There's a question up here I see on the screen about the name change. So we're keeping the Philadelphia University name for some very specific things on campus. So for example, the new Honors Institute is called the Philadelphia University Honors Institute. So that's a new honors program that's going to be for the whole university, and it will maintain the Philadelphia University name. But the university itself will be, the formal name is Thomas Jefferson University. The common name for the university will be Jefferson, as you saw in some of the slides. If that's confusing to you, the best example I think of is Stanford. Stanford is actually the Leland Stanford Junior University. That's their legal name, but everybody calls it Stanford. Same here, Thomas Jefferson University is the legal name. Jefferson is the common name. Says the number of graduates in the 1970 class was 181. Please check. I'm not sure about that one. Do you know?
We will check that. There were over 200 based on our list that we were pulling from the database. There were over 200, but certainly we'll get back to the person who wrote that.
And, Veronica, there's a good chance that's like if you added up graduates from the fall, graduates from the spring, and graduates from the summer, that it was over 200. But the May graduation might have been 181.
Possibly, yes. Yeah. We'll look into that. Thank you.
And right now we're at about 8,000 students, and we're graduating 1,500 to 2,000 a year now.
Yes, it's definitely increased quite a bit since 1970. That's for sure.
And one nice thing about the merger that occurred was that pre-merger, Philadelphia University was considered a master's intensive university by the Carnegie classifications. Thomas Jefferson was considered a specialty university by the Carnegie classifications. So neither one of us was a comprehensive research university, but combined we are. So we're now on the National Comprehensive Research University list, which gets us much more national exposure.
It's fantastic. Let's see, do we have one more question here? Oh, no, that's the same one. Okay, I've got another one here. How much interaction do students between the two campuses have currently? So between Center City and East Falls, how much interaction do the two students have from each campus?
That's a good question. It's starting to happen. It's not as much as we'd like. The travel is the biggest issue. So with, believe it or not, in the COVID days, with things having to be done virtually, we've had more interaction in the last 9 months because we don't have to bring students to and from the campuses. The most interaction has been on student projects. We don't have a lot of classes that run with students from both campuses because of the mix of majors at both campuses and the levels. Downtown is probably almost all graduate, and East Falls is about two-thirds undergraduate and a third graduate. But there's a lot of projects that are from the downtown campus that are then done by students on our campus with experts from downtown on the team. So that's been the most common interaction to date.
And it's increasing.
Yes. Oh, yeah. It's definitely going up now. Yeah. And as soon as we start a shuttle, that'll make a big difference. We were just ready to start a shuttle in the spring semester when COVID happened.
Yes, I think a couple of our staff members did use the shuttle in the early stages. And then, yes, said COVID happened.
A great question here about tuition. That is a funny question. Right now, comprehensive tuition for the year is about $40,000. But that's before any scholarships or anything like that. A student probably net is paying between $20,000 and $25,000 a year for an undergraduate.
Let's see. Well, we've got another one here.
Yeah.
So the
Jefferson Health, which is the clinical pillar of the universe of the enterprise, is the 14 hospitals. The university is a much smaller piece of the puzzle financially, of course, but this is a great example of where we have had really, really good student research projects brought to us from the clinical pillar. The hospitals have been really interested in using industrial design, graphic design, engineering, textile design. Right now, we have a project going on for the surgical unit called Gorilla Gown, which has our fashion design, textile design, and engineering students working on a gown that will keep patients warm during surgery, because body temperature drop is a definite indicator of problems. And it's very difficult to keep them warm through surgical procedures. And that's a great research project that came from the clinical pillar to the university, for example.
Fantastic, Dean Kander. Well, thank you so much for answering our questions, and we really appreciate your time once again.
My pleasure.
Thank you. And thank you also to Dan McCrate for co-hosting with us. We really appreciate your time as well, Dan. And before we depart, we wanted to share a special video highlighting a day in the life of two of our students. We have Carly McNall, who is graduating in 2021, and Lindsay Ferrano, who is graduating in December, class of 2020. So we bid you farewell. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Carly McNall. I'm currently a student in my last year at Jefferson University's East Falls campus. So I will be graduating with the class of 2021. I am originally from Delray Beach, Florida, and I came all the way here to major in fashion merchandising and management while also minoring in textile design. And on top of that, I have the privilege of being the president of the Future Alumni Association at the East Falls campus. And today I'm just going to take you on what a typical Monday looks like for me this semester. So I just came inside to start class, which I usually do just so the background noises doesn't distract anyone or myself. And I am waiting to get into my first class of the day. I have some breakfast with me and yeah, I'll be. So I just finished up with my classes for the day and made a quick lunch. And now I'm just getting ready to clock into my internship, which is actually based in Philadelphia, even though we're online for the time being. I work at Print Fresh Studios, which is a textile design studio here. And I have been working there since September 2019. So I just celebrated my year with them last month. And I more specifically work under their lifestyle brand called Print Fresh. And right now we're focusing on sustainable screen printed PJs, if you wanted to check those out. And yeah, so every single day since the quarantine has started, I have biked or driven or walked or whatever it may be to watch the sunset. And it started as a way to structure my days and have something to look forward to at the end of the day in the height of the quarantine. But now I just can't stop. And it's been a really nice treat to have at the end of the day to kind of slow down and have something to look forward to, even as this still progresses. But yeah, and it's been really nice. So I just walked home from sunset and I already have some dinner going on behind me. But the rest of my day is just gonna look like me eating dinner with my roommates and getting some homework done for my class tomorrow and a little bit of studying. And yeah, so this is basically what my Monday has been looking like during this semester in the pandemic. Thank you so much for following along. Bye.
Hi, my name is Lindsay and I am currently on my last semester at Jefferson as a pre-med major, and this is a day in my life. Right now, I'm waiting for my microbiology class to start, which is my first class of the day. Wednesdays are usually my long days, so we're in for a very long day of classes. I just finished my physics exam, which means I have some time before my next class starts at 12. So what I usually do is take a break, maybe get a coffee. If I was on campus, I would usually be getting a coffee by now. And then I would take a little mental break, or if I didn't have an exam, I would be going through my to-do list, looking through my planner and seeing if I can do anything in between classes. So after my pathology lecture, which was at 12, I have a little break until 2, where my pathology lab starts. Usually on Wednesdays, I have a lab attached to my pathology course, which sometimes I go in for it, other days I don't, and this week will just be virtual. And so before that, I ended up getting dressed because I will be going to work after my lab. One of the awesome things about Jefferson is the opportunities we get in and out of the classroom. In my pathology class specifically, we're able to go through case histories of actual patients and be able to identify and assess it ourselves in groups, which is really awesome. My lab ended around 4:45, which usually sometimes it's shorter and sometimes it's longer. But if I do end up finishing early, like I did today, I get my work done and I just finished a few microbiology notes along with a quiz that I have due on Sunday and then get ready for work. So I work on Wednesdays at a doctor's office as a medical assistant. And when I get home from work, I usually get ready for the end of the night. If I have any extra work or if I have an exam that I need to study for, I'll do that. But that consists of my day as a student at Jefferson. Thanks so much for following along.
Thank you all for joining us this evening once again, and congratulations to the class of 1970. We're very excited to have celebrated with you. And We hope to see you next year in person, where we will celebrate in person with the class of 1971. In the meantime, we hope that you will join us later for some of our upcoming programs, including a talk we have next week, sharing breast cancer must-knows, a 30-minute virtual Zumba session with fashion merchandising alumna Gina Gerton, and a look at the vaccine race. You can find more information on these events and a number of other upcoming alumni programs at jefferson.edu/alumni events. I also invite you to visit our reunion hub at any time at jefferson.edu/EF reunion hub to find the links to the Class of 1970 yearbook, a video reflecting on the 1970 men's basketball national championship season, a campus store discount, games, and more. We also invite you to consider supporting student scholarships through our Reimagine Scholarships Initiative. Make a gift today at jefferson.edu/reimagine scholarships and take advantage of a one-to-one match made possible by Johnson & Johnson. You may designate your gift to support student scholarships within your academic program or others within the university. Thank you once again for joining us, and stay well. Bye-bye.